theater here and act. We just want to remind you that there is no food or drink other than water allowed in our beautiful theater. So water's cool. If you're going to take a snack, just go outside. Thank you so much. I am Stacey Vokasek.
And I'm Christina Duquette.
And we are the dynamic duo known as the English and Creative Writing Teachers here at ACT. We're so excited that you're here with us. The kids have been working super hard on these pieces, and they're so excited to share them with you tonight. So we've got a lot of poetry, a little bit of fiction, but mostly poetry. We've got some collaborative pieces for you, and we're just really excited that you're all here with us tonight.
The kids have worked really hard and have a great show put together, so we're excited for all of you to enjoy the show. Before we begin, please silence your cell phones and any other electronic devices. For the safety and enjoyment of our performers and guests, flash photography is prohibited during a performance. In the unlikely event of an emergency, please proceed through the illuminated exits at the back of the theater. And exit the building through the lobby. Please note that the nearest exit may not be the door you entered through. Thank you and enjoy the show.
World of swirling colors. I am a world of swirling colors. I'm versatile and can be anything you want me to be. I can bring warmth to the air around me. My thoughts are light and bright, like thick white paint that with just a squeeze or two of blue that I found at the back of the art closet. But I also see myself lost in the deep ocean, stranded, the pressure pushing me down.
Thin spider webs. Trails of black ink drag across the surface, scarring the bright colors with deep trenches of dark pigment. I feel slimy, inky tendrils of hurt inside me that claw the way up my ribcage and rip through the bottom of my lung.
I try desperately to cover the black line with green, drizzling spirals to distract from the webs that the darkness weaves. I can't wait. I can't sit still. It's eating at me every day. My impatience is a rich emerald green. Trying to cover my mistakes before they can become noticeable, despite my tiredness and lack of motivation. I feel like the sky in the middle of a starry night, illuminated by the moon and stars.
A myriad of blues, direct, hardworking, and awfully intense inside me. Calm and grounded, understanding and gentle, I'm cyan to relieve my own stress. Cool clouds hover over the calm, patient, and quiet. I see them bundle together, going along with all of the strange things that have happened in my short but overstuffed life. I am painted purple with imagination.
Underneath the purple-red orbs, bubbling, frothing, the red that courses through my veins hovers around me. My skin is fevered and my temper rises, yet somehow red maintains its valor, courage and soul. It means so much more than baseless anger which seeps out of my pores.
And lines of warm tongues start to flow around like halos. A light early spring swirled in with buttercup petals. Gold flecks of shiny sequins sparkled and adds texture to my gold glittery aura. It doesn't stand out, but it accents the piece perfectly, like a sun in a painted picture.
In the end, the art that is me is a complicated mess of colors and textures. It's not perfect, it's not neat, but still something. Something truly, painfully me. something I can be unapologetically, a world of swirling colors.
Doing this right, or is this where I go? I am the anxious one.
I am the one that barely seems that way on the outside, smiling and laughing, making jokes and having a good time. I am the one that is fighting for my life on the inside. Asking how things can go wrong, trying to keep the mask up. Smile, say this, what is your face doing? What did they say? I am the anxious one.
Maybe I'm just overthinking things. I should calm down. Let's just keep this show rolling instead of worrying.
No, you should be worried.
No, it's fine. We might not plan on having three hosts, but we can make this work.
I don't think that's what Lynn's talking about.
That's right. I'm talking about the fire we started.
Wait, what? Why did you...
I mean, that's what it says.
Yeah, it does say that.
Not...
No, that's the next piece. Maybe we should just go back to one host.
No, we don't have to go that far. Instead, we'll go to our next piece. Please welcome Mason Morgan on stage with his piece, The Fire We Started.
The Fire We Started. The Minoka sits on a viney-tangled tree, leather hands fingering his flute. His thumb brushes over the tubes of hollowed cane. His nails scratch gently along the nightshade wrapped around them. Sighing, he lifts his flute up to his lips and starts to play. Eyes closing, he pours a soft, somber tune, taking his time playing each note. Warblers and chickadees alike sit together in silence, listening to the lullaby of the creature they've come to love. Squirrels hang off of low branches, wishing to stay close to the sweet melody. Fawns and does watch from afar, admiring the gentle giant in his almost sheepish exterior. Even the forest stops swaying in the wind to hear the gentlest of notes play. Only when a crunching of leaves approaches does the forest run off. Birds flit away while squirrels climb up the branches. Deer run to their home, nudging their children to trot faster. The Minoko finishes his tune, opening his eyes. He peers down to the little girl below. She stares at him, curiosity pulling him closer. Her chapped lips form an emotionless line across her dirty face. She clutches a teddy bear with one arm, the other dangling loosely by her side. Her large dark eyes peer into him. The Minoka shakes his head, clearing his throat. Who are you, child? Why have you come here?
Had such a beautiful rhythm to it.
Maybe you were hearing the Minoka's flute as well?
Flute music is great, but personally, I love sea shanties. The ocean has always been so vast in opportunities.
I just love the water. And ships are also so wonderful.
You mean the poem or the seafaring mode of transport?
What?
I thought you were hosting. That's what's happening now, right? Whatever. I'm still not sure, though I am sure that our next performer will blow you all away. Welcome to the stage, Annabelle Brown, with her piece, Ships.
Ships. Women are like ships. Both picked apart in mind, pronouns, and perceptions. Flesh reassembled into wood, hung on oak like ornaments. A pale belly swells with breath and sail, creaking helms fill with water. Wood rot aches and cracks apart until the ocean swallows like a creature, devouring salt water, stomach acids digesting deep in its belly. Words fall on empty ears. Stale air in lungs rasps and twists, turns sour like an underwater cave. Stomach tangles like seaweed, stretching and struggling to reach a glimpse of sunlight. Barnacles stick and crunch at neurons, a disturbing pressure, words will never reach the surface. Even silent ships sink. Hulls creak, and voice box vibrations still fall on deaf ears. But women are not ships. We may be treated like them, but our lungs have breath and our hulls have voices. When we sink, we rise, pushing back to the surface. Alike only in pronouns, ships and women are not the same. We are not yours.
Can't find her. First she doesn't know the next poem, and now she's gone. How did you two get into this position in the first place? She has to be somewhere within these walls, right?
Wait. You're making fun of Lynn for not knowing the order of pieces. But you don't even know the next piece, do you?
Of course I do. It's,
Oh my, I can't believe you would think you're fit to be the only host from the get-go. Our next performance is Lynn Rose with her piece, I Never Felt Like Madison.
That's it. You hadn't cut me off, that is.
What a...
I never felt like Madison. I hear my mother call me. I hear the name that was given to me. The name that's supposed to be me. It's not... but it doesn't feel right. A simple city name my parents saw that sounded nice became my moniker. It's not who I am or who I want to be. I feel distraught. I'm like a flower that wants to bloom, but it can't. The wind's too harsh and there's not enough sunlight yet. However, I have another name. One everyone knows me by. It's filled with laughs and memory. It feels right. It's a breath of fresh air, breaching the surface of the water after drowning for so long. A piece carved out of me by the hands of who accepted me.
Great job, Lynn. You did amazing.
Thanks, but where's Grisship?
Sorry, I was just trying to get as much heat from the fire as possible. It's getting really cold.
Well, winter is coming and calling. You might as well get used to it.
I'm sure our next piece will help you acclimate to the cold. As Gray Videos will perform their piece, Winter Calls, give them a warm welcome.
Frostbite. So cold.
Do we need help? Do we need to call a doctor?
Oh, leave him to rot. It's not worth the while.
I'm sure we have someone who knows about that. Our next performer, Avery Callahan, with their piece, Lead Me to Rot.
Leave me to rot. Disapproval forms vines in my ribs, vines in my core in shadowy agony. It strangles, chokes, suffocates. Gasps for breath can't possibly suffice for the precious air my lungs lose. I apologize. I swear I'm really sorry. Momentary regret worsens the pain. Despite my condition, you see it. You ignore my pleas for relief. The apology I pour my heart into falls unheard. Use me for all I'm worth. Wring the purpose and soul out of me. Rob me of autonomy, of choice, steal from my ingenuity, and make me unable to reject. Binds tie in. Hold on to me with your grip that refuses to set me free. It's sickening, nauseating, but you don't really care, do you? As long as you get what you want, just leave me to rot.
My fin feels like it's crawling.
Stop focusing on people's skin, Christian. It goes deeper than surface level.
Yeah, don't let Veronica Cruz catch you talking like that. You'll understand why after hearing her piece, you only see our skin.
Real.
Embellished with batons and gold badges. Headlines of police brutality scream into the ears of those who mimic brick walls. Skin color becomes a hindrance when it's darker compared to skin that resembles the ivory petals of daisies. Arrested for flesh of the night sky in a world dominated by white privilege, even though it's full of color. Anger burns in hearts and coils into words laced in passion like mace sprayed in eyes, strangled lungs trying to breathe. Golden badges become a symbol of tyrant's power instead of honors bestowed upon heroes for the people. Protectors of only those who don't live in slums, streets that blast music of different languages, scared because we are different. An epidemic that goes beyond disease. For years, names of lives taken too soon shouted like battle cries. Ignored countless times, we are fallen upon deaf ears until they have a story, a death. Seen as foul, and yet we are oppressed by their actions. Our crimes are remembered more than our kind hearts, more than the good we've done. Instead, they see us as savages, monsters, criminals. All because of our skin.
That piece was certainly an eye-opener.
I can see so many things, it's incredible.
The sky, the ocean, the land, the plants, and oh so beautiful flowers.
We already went over the ocean, so let's focus on the land now, especially the flowers.
Flowers are great. I just wish I could put it into words. Instead, I think Jocelyn Duhan should do it for us with her piece, Tulips.
Tulips. There's a spot in my yard where tulips grow. Every year they bloom in the same place. Vines mingle with our crumbling stone wall. Stems stand strong in the same spot. Years have changed the color of dewy petals. Blush pinks turn to crimson reds. Golden leaves morph into bright yellows with the summer sun high in the sky. Irises began to blend with them, periwinkle petals drooping towards the ground.
vibrant green grass creating a backdrop of shadows dancing across the dirt. Tulips didn't grow this year. The stone wall, barren and clear, no longer overlooked by blinding colors, vines lying lifeless on the ground. Irises had alone that summer, once standing strong in the wind, now falling with every breeze, its hope lost without the tulips. Daffodils showed up the next spring, bringing memories from the past, the same blush pinks and bright yellows that used to paint the tulips. It's like the tulips were rebirthed to daffodils, hope and joy consuming the darkness in my life when I no longer had a presence to hold on to. I never wanted a favorite flower. I never wanted to simplify my love to just one, but if I had to choose, I would choose tulips and irises and daffodils.
I love flowers, they're so beautiful.
I've always thought of flowers like family members. They all share something in common, but in the end, they vary so much it can make for an incredible array of color.
My uncle is... well, certainly colorful, yes. That's a nice way to put it.
Is your uncle named Jack, by any chance?
No, why?
No, Lynn, why would you start
off? Oh, ho, ho, look who doesn't know the next piece now. Finally, I was right, just as time came. I'm right, always have been, and always will be. That simple. Wait, no, time is performing on Jack. Not a speech about my greatness. Oh well, I'm still right when I say, let us welcome Time King to the stage, performing their piece, Uncle Jack.
I stepped off the school bus at the bottom of my uncle's long, winding driveway. I shouldered my backpack and waited for the school bus to rumble on before starting to the house. The driveway curved up a small hill, then sloped steeply down to the house. It was a hassle of a walk in the warm, late spring weather. Mostly hidden by the hill, the house couldn't be appreciated from the road. Only the tips of its steep copper roofs, smudged with green oxidization, could be seen. The bushes greeted me as I passed, their leaves whisking against my backpack and pants. The house came into view, its curved marble arches and finely sculpted stone sides an impressive sight in the green, wooded property. Freya and Ares, the Doberman guard dogs, jumped up as I neared their doghouse, straining against their chains to greet me. "Hey, puppies." I knelt down and pet both of their sleek heads, dutifully scratching Ares' belly when he rolled onto his back. I looked to the house, surprised that my uncle wasn't in the doorway or on the balcony to greet me. He usually met me after school with a cup of tea and a cookie, and he wasn't due to leave for his next business trip until next week. I realized the lights in the house were off, and my uncertainness grew. Freya caught my attention with a whine and laid next to her brother, resting her head on her paws. I reached to pet her back before noticing a small cut between her shoulder blades. "Oh, Freya, honey." I touched the wounded area, crusted blood already forming a scab. "What happened?" She offered no reply but a sigh. I pet her and promised her a treat, then stood, picking up my bag, and walked to the door. I tried to open it, but it was locked. I peered inside, but the house looked undisturbed. The stairway wound to the ceiling next to the chandelier's glass shards held high above the floor. Tables, chairs, and sofas sat cheerfully around windows, and every door was closed. "Okay?" I steadied my breathing as my anxiety rose. Freya trotted over to me and pushed her head under my hand. "All right, you're right," I said to her, then laughed as Ares shoved his nose into my hand as well, looking for attention. "Thanks, you two." I looked toward the back of the house, knowing there was a door with a keypad, and I knew the code. "Ares, you come with me. I need some support." I unclipped Ares' chain and chirped, "Heel." We walked together along the side of the house. I was on edge, but Ares provided a level of protection that calmed my nerves. Every bush and branch looked threatening now. The keypad door was solid metal, nestled in the wall of a small square of stone protruding from the house. I typed in the passcode, small beeps filling the otherwise silent afternoon as I touched the numbers. As I input the last digit, the door clicked, and I turned the doorknob. It opened easily, though it was heavy, and I was greeted with a dark stairway to the basement. Ares growled, clearly as uneasy as I was. "Shush, boy," I assured him, and reached down to hook my fingers around his collar. We stepped down the stairs, my sneakers making small, echoey thumps, and Ares' claws clicking lightly on the concrete. We reached the bottom of the stairs, where a wooden door stood as the last line of defense. I pushed on it, but it didn't budge, so I threw my shoulder against it. It swung open easily, and I stumbled into the basement. The basement was smaller than the house, but still a decent size. It was all one room, shaped in an L. The door and stairs were situated in the outer crook of the L, facing the short side. At the end of the long side, a spiral staircase led into the rest of the house. The basement was crammed with items. Boxes and furniture stood around, layers of dust on their surfaces. The basement served mostly as storage, excluding the house facilities like the boiler and the electricity panel. I walked to the stairs, Ares lagging behind to sniff at items. The wooden steps creaked as I climbed them, and the railing wobbled when I leaned on it. When I reached the door at the top of the stairs, it swung open easily, and I stepped into the living room. A plush carpet covered most of the hardwood floor, and several different chairs and sofas faced a coffee table in the center of the room. I was about to start searching the house when Ares, who had run up the stairs after me, started growling. I turned to him, and he was baring his teeth at the wall, pointing with a crooked paw, the stub of his tail held parallel to his back. I followed his gaze along the wall, where a dagger was buried halfway to its hilt, pinning down a note. My heart skipped a beat as I stepped closer to read what it said. The front of the note only had four words, scrawled in pen. "You are in danger."
I would get as far away from there as possible.
You would abandon your uncle?
You wouldn't be abandoning, per se, right?
That's most literal, perfect example of abandoning. Go as far as possible when someone is in need. Les Marie de Jesus might be on your side, though, with her peace far from you. Let's see what she has to say.
Far from you. The words I want to say to him swirl in my head like water in a pool. I want to let the water out to tell him the truth of how he hurt me. But the little voice inside my brain covers my mouth each time I try. I don't like confrontation. I never want to hurt anyone intentionally. But I'm always ready to see blood. When someone belittles me, don't doubt that I will fight back. I don't want to be my dad. Never knowing how to keep calm, always trying to solve problems with violence. But that little voice inside my brain tells me I'm just like him. Like a shark closing in on its prey, these thoughts cloud my mind. I don't know how to calm this anger. As white-capped waves crash inside me, making it impossible to speak.
See, Lisbury's piece proves me right. Confrontation does not matter.
I don't think you understand the piece that well.
Well, at least I was right. You still shouldn't have banned people.
That's what I said. You said the opposite.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
I think I remember you only asking, not saying your stand on the situation.
Can you two stop bickering. We have a performer who is waiting to share their piece. Talon Phelps, with their piece, your skin is not a part of you.
Your skin is not a part of you. You are not you. If you think about it, all you are is an odd lump of stuff. You're a puzzle of what you contain. An evenly beating heart, ever goopy mess of brains, of ever vibrating bones, all encased in a layer of skin that is not a part of you. A layer of skin that constantly surrounds you, but is never really you. Your skin doesn't matter. It only contains the parts of you that do, even if you hate them. Your bad back, your never working lungs, your always aching head. Those parts may not make things fun, but imagine where you would be without them. Without the skin that holds your unfamiliar form in place. You would be nothing but a pile of blood. Red dries onto your removed skin in a sticky sheet of goopy iron. Still shivering bones crack as they hit the road, encased in a thin layer of stringy tendons. Tangles of hair soaked with blood and tied with gray brain matter. Long lines of intestines fallen like sausages around the street, still processing the lack of connection to your stomach. Muscles seizing and steady with rigor mortis. You'd be nothing but roadkill. Even less than that. It would be less valuable than a squirrel hit dead on the side of the road, crushed like a tube of toothpaste without every part of you, without that skin that isn't quite a part of you but away from you. It floats around you and holds you tight. Your body is strange. It functions in odd ways. It is more you than you are it.
Another piece about skin reminds me, guys. Remember Dr. Veronica's piece we talked about the sea, the ground, and the sky? We never visited the sky, right?
The sky is not important. Let's introduce our next performer.
No. We need to go back to the sky. We can't let go of it.
Is the sky within these walls, Christian? No, it isn't. Move on!
I am done with you two. You want to be hosts? Go ahead. I quit.
He literally makes no sense.
Maybe the next piece can help with that, even if not for him. That next piece being Sense and Sense, performed by Mason Morgan.
Filled with broken promises. We live in a world where my parents had to save up their money just so they could afford the cheaper option by 23 cents. I will not be silenced. We will not be silenced over the broken system, the broken promises, and the empty pockets of those yearning for a better future.
Is he still pouting?
Seems like it.
Oh, no, 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 no!
Lynn, are you okay? What is it?
Why is he next? He has to be next!
By him, you mean?
I do. Next up is Christian Gilardo with his piece, Wind Woven Thoughts.
He just had to get the air in there, didn't he?
The wind sang a different song from the normal melody I always heard. Whimsical with an odd, soothing strength, warm and soft. But today was different. It was colder. It felt like something was on the horizon as the dark energy rattled through my bones, carried from the wind to my very being. A storm was coming. The wind always brought me messages. Some may call them premonitions, but the wind always seemed to know things before they happened. It travels the world and picks up trinkets of thought and gadgets of the mind. It has always shared its treasures with me. It felt like some gift passed down from a greater being, a control that I never understood. As to why this gift was given to me, I feel like it never was. Instead, that it's always been a part of me. But at this point, I shouldn't ponder the wind's thoughts. Instead, take its warnings. I close my windows, but the wind seems upset with my decision. It rages louder and louder, drowning out my symphony of thought, residing me back to this world.
But I honestly loved that piece.
I guess it wasn't terrible.
You said you loved it?
Oh, don't get so full of yourself.
Wait, Lynn, I think I know where he's going with this.
Wait, yeah, I see it, I see it. He's talking about Annabelle Brown, right?
With her piece, The Lovers?
I think you guys are finally getting a hang of this whole hosting thing. Well, let's go make room for a performance.
Lovers. I dole out tarot cards in search of hidden meanings, fingers fumbling with crinkled edges. My breath leaves when I catch her gaze, as if I hold secrets that stretch beyond the painted papers I hold in my hands. I am trapped in her hazel eyes. Irises reflect and fragment a world of sparkling galaxies. Her pupils dilate, expand to black holes that consume time and space until only she is left. The tarot is forgotten. Warm fingers press prints into my skin. I memorize the sensation of soft hands so that if I let go, I'll remember. She holds my pulsing heart in her palm, peppers my skin with little love marks like the sun-cast shadows of an oak tree. A prophecy radiates in patterns on my skin, more tangible than the scattered major and minor arcana can foretell. Hands and heartbeats interlace in the midst of late-night revelations. Bent tarot and bedsheets wrap us in the present while possibilities burn in our fingertips. The lovers lay between us, whispering a promise foretold.
You know, I'm glad you're finally accepting us as hosts, Christian.
Lynn, it might be a bit late now.
Wait, is it that time already?
It is.
I do hate to break it to you all, but this is our last piece of the night. Back at the 20th anniversary Act Gala, we had a ton of people build phrases out of words we had set up. Together, some of our writers put it into a piece. And here that piece is. We've titled it, Whispers.
Whispers.
A whisper. From soft kisses, pink hearts glow in a quiet forest, blooming together in a song of true laughter. Holy wishes inflame a tree in passion. This raw love begins today. Aches like song and storm, the wild cold, black and green.
A whisper. From quiet, thriving thoughts. Stones soft beneath the lake. They're peaceful. Like frost melting with the sunrise, a garden of light made to worship winter's true wishes.
A whisper from earth, a barefoot melody. Women who climb about the planet think not as birds, but as the sky. They all carry each other, knowing each soul clutches a song of light.
A whisper from wonder in every show.
It's so much fun as well. I'm super excited for our next Coffeehouse in May.
Which is sadly where we'll have to see you all next, because that is the end of our February 2023 Coffeehouse from within these walls. Thank you all so much for coming out to the show. We hope you all enjoy and that you all have a wonderful night. Goodbye.
Thank you.
tonight that are really important for us. So our writers have been working so hard and submitting to all sorts of contests. So we would like to bring out 3 out of the 4 Scholastic Writing Award nominees, because
they won.
So Lynn and Talon and Avery, can you come on out, please? Won 2 recognitions for her work, but Lynn, Lynn, this is an honorable mention for your Imperfect Muscle Memory piece. Talon, for your short story, A Long Gone Train, a Silver Key, everybody. That's it. And Avery, a Silver Key for your Endearment short story. So these are
award-winning writers in-house. Yeah, just today we got this news. So we had 3 writers enter the Twisted Tales competition back in October, and we found out that all 3 of our writers won. So we'd like to recognize Avery, Veronica,
so proud of our students. We are so proud of you for loving them, for supporting us. So thank you for coming. I hope you enjoyed all the work. Have a great night. Drive safe.
Thank you.